Hey everyone, I just did a video on how encryption works. And in that video, I realized I said the term XOR a whole bunch of times. So in this video, I want to quickly review what is XOR. And it's really all to do when we're dealing with binary. So we have some zeros and ones, and we're gonna do some interaction with some other zeros and ones. This could be individual bits, it could be an array of bits. But the whole point is we're doing some operations between two sequences of bits to get another sequence of bits. And when we think of this, it's very common that one is true, zero is false. Remembering binary, it can only be one or zero. It's one of those two states. And so we perform some action on two bits that gives us another bit. And those actions, we commonly think of AND and OR. So I'm going to review those first. And we use AND and OR all the time in life. I could think of, we'll start with AND. So if we think of the AND operation, and I can think about, we have the idea of a truth table. And I can think of, well, there's values coming in. So one set of values could be 0 and 1, and the other set of values could be 0 and 1. Then the result is if we AND those values together. So if I AND those values together, well, if it's 0 and 0, the result is 0. So if I'm doing some truth, is if this is false and this is false, well, the result is false. If one of them is true, but the other is false, well, if the AND, I need both to be true. So it's still false. This one is false and this one is true, it's still false. But if both of them are true, then the result is true. I could say, for example, hey, if you tidy your room and take out the trash, then you can have a candy bar. So I can think that's an AND. Both inputs have to be true to get a true output. We also commonly think of OR. So we'll have the truth table for OR as well. And once again, we'll have those same two options coming in. And this time the idea is if one of them is true. So it could be, hey, if you eat your vegetables or you have an apple sauce, then you can have dessert. Now, as long as one of those things is true, then you get dessert. If you ate your vegetables and an apple sauce, well, you still did one of them, so you still get a dessert. So here the result comes out as, well, okay, if both are false, you don't eat the vegetables or the apple sauce, well, it's false, you don't get anything. But now, if one of them is true, you've eaten your vegetables, or you didn't eat the vegetables, but you ate the apple sauce, it's true. If you ate both, hey, it's still good. It's one of them has to be true, or they could both be true. So if OR, as long as one of them or both are true, then the output of that is true. Then we get to XOR. So this is exclusive OR, and that's really the big deal, and it kind of gives you the hint of what's going to come out of this anyway. If it's exclusive OR, it has to only one of them be true. They can't both be false, they can't both be true. So with XOR, exclusive OR, and in my pictures I drew in the encryption video, I used this sign. So we have the same truth table again, and you probably can already guess what the output of this is going to be. If they're both false, well then the output is false. If one is true, then it's true. If this is false but this is true, it's true. But if they're both true, then it's false. And that's the big deal with exclusive OR. It's exclusively OR. It cannot be both of them are true. So that's where it's different from the regular OR. It's just that exclusive relationship. And this is extremely powerful in many things when we think of computers. But what I used was encryption. Because with encryption, the whole point is when I do an exclusive OR, if I run the exclusive OR again on the result, it puts me back to the original state, which is a really powerful thing. The other nice thing about exclusive OR is it will keep our result within a certain size. It's never going to overflow. It's never going to underflow. It will keep it in the exact size because I'm only ever flipped. I can never have 1, 1 come out at 1. So it's always going to keep me within a certain size. So if I took my example of my encryption, if I had some plain binary and it was just 1, 0, 0, 1. And then remember we had our encryption function, we had a key. The key is what made the encryption function come out with some unique sequence that looked random, but it's actually not. It's based on an algorithm, it's based on using our key and a certain round key. So we had our encryption algorithm using our key, and that spat out some binary. So let's say 1, 0, 1, 0. So the ciphertext would be the output of that. So if we take our encrypted value, so our ciphertext, so exclusive OR of 1 and 1, in fact, let's write in that exclusive OR. So what we're doing is an exclusive OR on these values. So 1 and 1, well, that's 0. 0, 0, that's 0. 1 and 0, that's 1. 1 and 0, that's 1. So that would have been our ciphertext. So we had the output of the encryption and our plain text, we XORed them to get our ciphertext. But now when I receive the ciphertext and I know the key, we have a symmetric, a shared key, I don't actually have to use a different algorithm to decrypt. I just run the same encryption algorithm, but instead of XORing the output of the encryption with the plain text, I now XOR the ciphertext with the output of the encryption. So it's the same encryption. One time I'm XORing it with the plain text, and then I just run it again with the cipher. And if I follow through this XOR, so 1 and 0, XOR is 1. 0 and 0 is 0. 1 and 1, well, that's 0. 1 and 0 is 1. And as you can see, we're back to our original message. And so that's why the XOR is so nice, that it essentially enables us to reverse by just running the operation again. That's why it's so useful. I guess what I'm talking about, the most common things you might see, I should quickly mention NOT as well. NOT just operates on a single binary. So I have some binary of 0, 1, and NOT just flips it. So the NOT would just say, well, 0 becomes 1, 1 becomes 0. So just when you think about all the different options, just that's another common one you'll see. And that was it. I just wanted to really quickly go over really what that XOR meant. And again, why it's so powerful for keeping some operation within a fixed size. But also that if I run an XOR and then I run the XOR again, it will actually get me back to that original value, which is why it's so useful when we think about encryption and security. As always, I hope that was useful, and I'll see you on the next video.